This is Coogan Cassius for IFL TV in association with MTK Global. We're in Liverpool here. It's fight day. I'm joined by Liam Smith, who headlines tonight at the M&S Bank Arena against Sam Eggington. Does it feel weird to hear it being called the M&S Bank Arena?
Yeah, I had loads of questions before. Loads of people coming up to me. Where's that you're fighting? I'm like, it's just the Echo. It's just changed its name. Yeah, it's mad. But I think it's probably, it'll take a while for that name to sink in. People will always still call it the Echo. You know, it's the first. The first time, first name in the arena, so people always look called that.
I think a lot of people still called the Manchester Arena the MEN, yeah.
Yeah, they did, yeah, the MEN. I think we still call it that now. I don't even know what it's called now. Is it media or it went from the MEN to Manchester Arena to something else? Yeah, I don't know what it's even called now. It's had a few names, that one.
Absolutely. I think a lot of fighters, especially in Liverpool over the years, have kind of had memorable nights there. And it was the Echo then, so they still refer it to as the Echo. So, yeah, it's one of them things.
Yeah, they will. You know, everyone will still... It'll take a while for that M&S to sink in, you know what I mean? I think the Echo rolls off easier as well.
Absolutely. I know you've spoken about this, obviously, since it happened, but, the whole kind of move from Frank Warren to Eddie Hearn, why at this stage of your career did you feel that was the right thing to do now?
It was just a change was needed for me. Not necessarily, you know, a move from Frank to Eddie. It was, I was 10 years with Frank and I just felt like I needed a bit of a change. I felt I was going stale, but just like fading away a little bit, and I felt I needed the change to give me a little bit of fire back in my belly, and I just obviously decided a move. And then sitting down with a few people, obviously as soon as kind of sat with Eddie, my management team, MTK, that it made sense, you know what I mean? And so I left it to MTK and Eddie, and they come up with a three-fight deal, which I thought, yeah, three fights this year, it's exactly what I want. I moaned about the Munguia fight, inactivity played its part. So I feel three fights in quick succession, or three fights in the 12 months, is what I need.
I mean, to be fair, obviously the majority of your career you would have spent with Frank, and he delivered you the world title, yeah, the Canelo fight, the Munguia fight. So yeah, Frank played his part in your career as much as anyone will.
Definitely, and again we. I feel like getting my phone out and my phone went broke. I'd show you, you know what I mean? I've had a message yesterday off every single one of them. Right now, my phone's just gone and it was Emma. Worked for Frank, you know what I mean? So I've split with them on good terms, which is a good thing. You know, I don't want to make... If you don't need to split and be bitter, you don't have to. You know what I mean? And we split on good terms, and I'm happy with that. Frank said, and I said, some of my best nights in boxing... Well, all of my best nights in boxing have been with Frank. Now, obviously, I hope to God I can get some now with Eddie and Matchroom. But I've got nights, world champion, I'll remember for the rest of my life, and Frank delivered this. So, you know, we've got something that I'll never, ever forget. And I'm glad we have, you know, parted ways on good terms, because the last thing I wanted to do was be involved with him for 10 years and then split and be bitter and hate him and have to slag each other. So I'm glad it's gone the way it's gone.
Because, I mean, there was a point when Paul was active, that Paul, Stephen and Callum were kind of under the Matchroom ban, and you were the one under Frank. So I suppose that kind of worked well for your career, because you were kind of doing your thing, despite your other brothers all being with Eddie at the same time.
Yeah, it was. And people asked, like, why are you still with Frank when they're with Matchroom? And I was like, why is kind of Paul Pogba with Man United and his brother with someone in France? And, like... You know, people are under contracts, people play for different teams, and, you know, because the brothers are all with Matchroom, just me and I have to be at Matchroom at the time. I was happy with Frank, and, you know, we had a contract, and it was working on both ways, so I didn't need to. Obviously, then, towards the end, when I felt the feelings I was getting, you know, when I felt I was getting stale, or felt I was waiting for... Kind of, I didn't have a title, so I was waiting to be put on a kind of undercards, and... stuff like that, and I just thought, I'm not getting really big opportunities that I want, and just fights, just, you know, I'm in the gym, just lash me somewhere, just give me a fight on someone's bill, and that's where after applauds Eddie. Eddie's signed me right away and just gone, you know what, we'll lash him in Liverpool and we'll make a show around him. And, you know, a top show he's done. And then I feel Eddie be buzzing with this show because I guarantee you when he put this show together, he didn't feel it would do 8,000-9,000 tickets. And what I mean by that was, like, there's not, you know, when I say a massive name, obviously you've got big names on it, but there's not like a marquee name who's on stupid amounts of money, Coogan, that's what I'm trying to say. So I feel Eddie's put a good bill together, and I guarantee when you made this bill, if you'd have offered Eddie 4,000 tickets, he'd have took it. But it's kind of more than doubled that. So I feel the show's a massive success up to now, and hopefully it delivers tonight.
There hasn't been a show here at the formerly Echo now M&S Bank Arena since Conor Greco. So, and it's a bit weird when you think about it, because there was quite regular shows here in Liverpool, kind of at that arena, for, you know, you'd have two or three during the year at a minimum. But I think it's now time to start kind of rolling the shows out from this arena.
I said exactly that, the press conference, Coogan. We've been starved on nights like this, and it's criminal because of, regardless of promoters, if you sat here and named fighters, all the fighters you can from Liverpool, like top fighters and, you know, top prospects coming through and stuff, you think, wow, how aren't you having massive, massive shows, you know, every 3-4 months? Because the fighters we've got in Liverpool, we should be having many a night a year, like what, you know, like this, and big shows at the arena, because we've got so many talented fighters and so many good, you know, good name fighters that we should be having big nights like this more often, and hopefully this can kickstart it again. You know, we've had periods where we've had good shows in Liverpool, but it seems to have gone quiet for a little bit, and hopefully, you know, we can get the ball rolling again for Eddie's thinking, you know what, we'll go back to Liverpool next, you know, in a couple of months. So hopefully again, fingers crossed, everything's worked to plan. Hopefully the action tonight, you know, runs along with it.
Sam Eggington, on your Matchroom debut, why Sam Eggington? Was this opponent kind of discussed to you whether you would take that? Were there other fighters in the reckoning for this fight here on today?
You know what? I don't want to go too far into it, Coogan, but the day after I agreed to sign with Eddie, the offer was Sam Eggington. We agreed that as well. You know what I mean? It was the first name put to us for Liverpool, and just thought, yeah, you know what, it's a good fight. Sam's not going to come and bring no gimmicks, you know what I mean? I'm not going to have to search all the way through YouTube to find some African or Argentinian southpaw, no, like, you know, Boxrec telling me he's 6'1" and he's 5'11", 5'10". You know, like, things like that. I know Sam, I've sparred hundreds of rounds with him, and I know what he's going to bring, and he'll always bring a good, entertaining fight, so I just felt it made sense, especially for Liverpool. I don't want to be... I just think in this fight, there's no way I can look bad. You know, in boxing, win or lose, you know what I mean? I just think this fight gels well, stylistically-wise. We're both, you know, similar in the sense we both like a fight. We don't both don't hold. We both, you know, and it'll be exciting and competitive, definitely.
Obviously, you wouldn't be overlooking tonight, but what's the fights that you're particular kind of targeting now? Because am I right in saying you're kind of in the final phase of your career? Is that fair to say?
Yeah, it is, yeah. And it's not like kind of, you know, I'm in last chance saloon to a certain extent, obviously. But I'm 30 now, so, you know, you're talking about I've got, three years. I always said 33 is a good, said that for 8 years before, I've said 33, kind of, and I don't want to be in boxing. You know, I told my brother Paul, I sat down with him, you know, three of us, and said, kind of, you're done, you're losing to people you'd have never lost to, you'd have never, ever, ever lost to Tyrone Zuga. And we said, and it's sometimes a harsh conversation, but I know the minute I'm about to lose to someone that I'd have never lost to, I'll call her a day before, my three brothers tell me, because I'm not stupid like that, but I'm from too good a family. So you're all right in what you're saying. I am coming to the final part, and that's where I felt the little change needed. You know, I need a little change. The last couple of years, and that's where I thought Matchroom and Sky was the one.
So if you're going to kind of map out like a perfect, I know everything doesn't always go that way, but a perfect kind of final phase to your career, then what's the immediate aim? Is it to get into the biggest fights possible? Is it to win a world title again? Which is it?
Obviously, from the minute I lost the world title, that was my aim, but to win a world title again, set out to be, and it's still, that still burns. But the three fight deal that I've done at Matchroom, I'd love this one, you know, be out again quite soon, you know, not on the sideline for 5-6 months again. Be out, active again, and then throw any name you want at me at the end of the year and I'll take it. And that's what I'm, what that is, the position I'm in. I would love a world title. I would love a massive domestic fight with Kell Brook. People, you know, I didn't sign at Matchroom to fight Kell Brook. People automatically put two and two together there. But you can't deny he's a massive name. He's a massive fight in my division now. So they're the fights I want to be involved in. And I just think it, that come more and more to the top of the water when I sign at Matchroom. People just automatically, and sure you've seen yourself, Coogan, social media was just Smith, Brook, Smith, Brook, Smith, Brook, Smith, Brook. And I think people knew Brook has lost the Khan fight. So automatically, I think, well, you know what? If you're not fighting Khan, we'd like to see him fight Smith. And I'm sure, especially the British public, would like to see him fight me rather than, like, you know, Brandon Rios or somebody like that.
You've been linked with Brook and Khan throughout your whole career, really, haven't you? It's been always been kind of talked about, even that Amir Khan fight. But now, especially Kell Brook, now that you've kind of signed with Matchroom. So I suppose when you're looking in the division and around that weight, those are the fights that you would be targeting.
Yeah, definitely. They're just kind of fights that everybody wants to be involved in. But, you know, I want to be involved in a fight where you're going for a coffee with your mates and it comes on the, you know, comes on conversation. You know, what about Smith fighting Brook? Looking forward to that one. Like, I want to be in them type fights where people are talking about. And the names mentioned bring them conversations, you know, to the table. I want to be in decent fights where people are talking about, people are looking forward to, it sells, you know what I mean? And obviously then you look at it, beating names like that puts you right back in the mix.
Your brother Callum, we're awaiting a date to see whether he fights on that Usyk card in Chicago or whether he fights on the Joshua Miller card. But recent talk of him potentially at some point maybe facing Billy Joe Saunders. What's your thoughts on that, Liam?
You know, the talk of it is Billy Joe moving up to fight Sharif, whatever the kid's name, for the WBO if Ramirez vacated, which I think is a good move for Billy Joe, puts him a 2-weight world champion, and then puts him in the mix for massive, massive fights with Callum and the other champions because he holds a belt. But, you know, I like Billy Joe and I really get on Billy Joe, so I don't want to sound like I'm slagging Billy Joe, but Billy Joe and Callum is all wrong. I think Callum's too big and kind of, and he hates Billy Joe, honest to God, I do, but Billy Joe's not the biggest of middleweights, you know, never mind super middleweight. You're talking about an average-sized middleweight against an absolute huge super middleweight. So it's, you know, I feel, if you ask me now, Billy Joe and Callum Smith, I think Callum Smith's all wrong for Billy Joe. So if that's the question you're asking, that's my answer. But, you know, I think Billy Joe's a top fighter, top middleweight, and he's one of the best middleweights in the world. So I don't think... If I was in Billy Joe's shoes, it's hard for him as well. You know what I mean? He's getting offered a world title against the fighter that he'll beat. So I don't knock him for the going to Super Middleweight for that. But then, you know, where does he go from there? Because I think, you know, if you look at Billy Joe next to Callum Smith, Ramirez, stuff like that, the sizes are big. And you've just seen two absolute top fighters the other day. But size played its big part in Spence and Garcia.
Yeah, it was as one-sided as you're ever going to see that fight between Spence and Garcia, and all the hype around it, which is justifiably because of who the two fighters are. But it's not really, when you're watching a fight that's not really as competitive as you want, it's not really, I don't know if you take pleasure in watching kind of that one-sidedness of a fight.
No, I felt, because now I feel for Garcia, because people have just gone bang, because it was a one-sided, you know, beat down way in it really, and Garcia is an unbelievable fighter, You know, it was only before that fight you're talking, people were saying Garcia and Lomachenko is an unbelievable fight. So you know, you've got to remember that, and you can't just downgrade Mikey Garcia from that performance. The size played its part, mate, it did. And Errol Spence is a class big welterweight. Mikey Garcia is a class, you know, light welter, lightweight even. Mikey Garcia can still weigh lightweight. So you've got to remember, mate, he's a four-weight world champion for a reason.
Your stable mate, Anthony Crolla, travels out to LA very shortly, obviously for a huge fight with Lomachenko. And, you know, we kind of knew when this fight was announced what kind of the public perception would be looking at that. Not a lot of people giving Anthony much hope in that fight, but tell me why he has got a chance in that fight, Liam.
Yeah, I feel for him because, again, one of the nicest kids in boxing, one of the hard-working kids, achieved unbelievable things. But if something got put out next week saying Anthony Crolla got offered this much for Lomachenko and knocked it back, he would get stick. It got put out, Anthony Crolla accepts a fight with Lomachenko. By the way, mandatory, but Anthony Crolla's fighting Lomachenko, you get stick. So you can't win either way. You're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. That is the nature of the beast that we live in with the boxing public. It's brutal at times, so I'm sure people would have said to him, oh, he's a shithouse him. Got off a daff Lomachenko. So in that sense, you can't win with some people, but he hit the nail on the head. He's been in boxing 23 years for nights like this, and I just look at it as, if you're playing football for Wrexham Coogan, you want Manchester City, Man United or Liverpool in the FA Cup draw. And now people, why? You're in football for, you're in boxing for. He wants to test himself against the best in the world. You remember nights like that for years to come. You tell people, you know, I fought him in LA. And then with the fight in general, you know more than anyone, boxing is a strange sport and worse of things have happened in life. Crolla knows full well what he's up against. So do we, so does Joe. And obviously so do all the public. But he'll go there 100% fit, 100%, you know, determined to... It is a cheesy saying, but he's daring to be great, isn't he, really? And if he pulls an upset off, it's one of the biggest upsets in boxing. And again, he'll be remembered for forever. But he knows full well what he's up against, but he'll go there with 100% belief that he can do something and pull something out of the bag.
I mean, Amir Khan is in a similar-ish position where he's going in against Terence Crawford, and a lot of people fancy Terence Crawford to beat Amir Khan. You took that fight with Canelo a few years ago as well, and you're right in what you're saying. It's like you're in the sport to be in against the best, whether that's the pound for pound best at the time. And when you're talking about those kind of three fighters there, Lomachenko, Crawford, Canelo, you're talking about three of the top four or five pound for pound in the world now.
Somebody asked me, we had a conversation yesterday, and again, Coon, you've seen me screen on my phone, otherwise I'd show you, because I've sent a text last night to Callum, Paul and Stephen. The four of us are in a text. We were all having a conversation on that table yesterday, and it was the Crolla Lomachenko thing, and someone said, kind of like, do you think it's his last fight? I was like, well, for me, no, because you lose to Lomachenko, it'll make you retire, and I always had a long career and a good career, but I said, if I lose to Lomachenko, come back and just say Robert Easter and or like Barthelemy's got a world title. I said, like, there's differences. Lomachenko and Canelo are there. They're like, I was put elite. And then you've got your world-class fighters, like, you know, your world champions, but not your elite fighters. There's a handful, a small majority of them, like Crawford, Canelo, you know, people just mentioned. And so, for instance, if Crawler was to lose this and then Lomachenko, whatever, moves up or moves down the way he does, and you're telling me Robert Easter or Rantis Barthelemy's world champion, you wouldn't put Crawler in with them two then. So that, and then it got announced last night, Robert Easter's fighting Rantis Barthelemy for the WBA regular title, because I sent them, I was like, wow, they're the two names I mentioned today for Crawler. So if you were to lose to him and then you've got a world champion like that, I still feel Crawler can beat them too. So it's obviously depends what Crawler wants to do. Like,
just going back obviously to last year, no one gave Callum Johnson a prayer against Beterbiev, and he come very close, he dropped him within two rounds, and he come as close as you can do in a fight before he was eventually stopped himself. But if you don't kind of take these chances, you never know, and that could have easily have gone Callum Johnson's way that night in Chicago.
Yeah, it could have. And again, if you rewind the clock back to that, he got stick for taking that fight. He got, you know, and that fight has propelled his career massively. He made a big statement over there, as in, wow, this kid's just nearly done Berbatov. He probably, if you watch the fight back as well, he doesn't throw a shot after the knockdown, which he kicked himself for after the fight. Now, obviously, a class world champion in Berbatov, but, and then Callum Johnson's just gone back over there and done that to Monaghan. So, like, he's announced himself now, wow, he weren't just a one-trick pony and, you know, nearly pulled something out the bag. He can fight, mate, and he's going to be on the world scene again soon enough. So, that was part of taking a chance, but no one what he's got slated for, and some things can happen like that.
I know you probably want to get off. I've just got a couple more questions for you, Liam. I do want to ask your opinion on Sergei Kovalev and Anthony Yard. Kind of, this is all kind of the similar situations where people are kind of slagging Yard off for like fighting XYZ, but now he's going from XYZ to Sergei Kovalev. And what we're hearing from Frank and Tundi and everyone from the team is they want that fight next. So is that too early for Yard, a fight with Kovalev now?
It's hard to say too early because he's been in boxing, you know, a bit of a long time. He's had 19 fights or something, 20 fights. But the Yard thing frustrates me a little bit, Coogan, as in, The same lad seems very, you know, a good lad, and I can't really, I'm not knocking him, but just him as a whole, as you say, he's gone from fighting nobody to fighting Kovalev, and he's probably going to get a big shock and a big reality in that gulf of class. But he's been, as you say, he's getting a lot of stick for not fighting anybody, and if that's me, I'm thinking, well, hang on a minute, all right, then I will fight. I'll fight whoever you want. He got ordered to fight Jose Burton and pulled out of it. He got ordered to fight somebody. Now, there's four. There's probably more, but I'm just going to name the kind of top four in Britain for a while. How can you bypass them to Sergei Kovalev? You never fought Burton, you never fought Johnson, you never fought Buglioni, even Boatsy. So I feel you should have really... If he'd beat any one of them, he'd got the British public on side, and well, you know what, he can't fight, because there is the question marks, can he fight? He looks the bollocks at times, but then you think, well, who's he fighting? So I feel he should have just tried to beat one of them, and then he's got the British public, so know what, he can't fight, and he probably is one of our best in Britain at that weight, so let's back him on his road to the world title now. But people are still asking him questions, and he shouldn't, because he's fighting Sergei Kovalev next, he's mandatory. You know what I mean? It's mad, and it's hard. Like, I feel for them in one sense, but I think no, because like I'd just took the fight with Burton when the board made it, and instead of fighting somebody for a WBO European.
Yeah, I think kind of in that domestic scene, there is quite a few fights that could be made. We've seen some. Obviously, we saw Johnson, Buglioni.
Buglioni fought Johnson, and Buglioni probably got okay. Burton's probably going to fight Craig Richards. You know, it is what you have to do sometimes. And I just feel he should have done it. He just beat one of them and then bypassed them. And he's fighting Sergei Kovalev as a mandatory. We should be kind of saying he deserves this. He's battled his way to a mandatory position. And not, we're talking about why has he avoided all the top UK fighters.
One last one. Obviously, he made a fourth.
Sad. That was I was crying watching that because he's an Adidas ambassador. I was crying, honest. That was typical Tundi. I was laughing my head off at that.
To be fair, I think Tundi's probably Anthony Yard's biggest like promoter. Obviously, no disrespect to Frank, but he's the one kind of doing the talking all for Anthony. I think do you know what? I take no, they're confident and he's confident, and maybe it comes across a little bit brash and a bit whatever, but. Listen, if that's what he feels and that's his opinion, then why not?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. He's just stayed in the pot. He's probably one of them, mate. Good press or bad press, it's press, you know what I mean? And he just wanted to keep Yardy's name on the end of everyone's lips. And as long as people were saying, like, what the fuck's that Sunday on about A-side against Kovalev, people were still talking about him. So he's probably just stayed in the pot.
Just May the 4th, your old mate Canelo takes on Danny Jacobs. What chance do you give Jacobs in this fight?
A chance. He's a top middleweight, but I feel Canelo wins. I've said this for a long time. A lot of people wanted Jacobs, like Jacobs Canelo, for a while now, and especially after Jacobs and Golovkin. But I've always said Canelo beats Jacobs, and I think Canelo's going to do a proper job on Jacobs. Said it before. I think Daniel Jacobs is a top middleweight. He's a big middleweight as well, but I just think Canelo's at middleweight. I mean, Canelo's the best.
You would say that, wouldn't you?
No, mate, honestly, I do. I think middleweight kind of probably suits him now. He looked, especially the rematch of Golovkin, mate, he looked solid as anything came. And, you know, his ability speaks for itself, mate. His timing and that, he's a tough fighter, so I feel middleweight is weight.
Okay, Liam, thank you very much for talking to us on the day of your fight. I know it's not always ideal, but I appreciate you sitting down here for a while. Best of luck tonight. Boxing back at the M&S Bank Arena for the first time in 3 years. You haven't fought there in.
Yeah, it is. It's good to be back. I had my first defence in my world title here. It was, you know, obviously good show, and I'm glad to be back. 3 years again. We should be here more often, mate. It's one of the best fight cities in the world for me. And we need big nights like this.
You believe you stop Edgerton tonight?
Yeah, I do. Obviously, I'm not going to go out and try and throw my eggs in one basket and stop him and let Sam come into the fight late, you know, where I've emptied the tank. But I just feel I let Sam too often, too cleanly, and I feel I'll get to stop it, yeah.
Liam Smith, thank you very much, and hopefully we'll grab a word of you after your fight tonight, but appreciate your time here.
Thanks for me, Tar. Thanks.